years, were together in the executive board of Fraunhofer. He stayed on. So he is the longest serving executive board member of Fraunhofer. By the way, Fraunhofer is 20,000 people, 2.1 billion euros, and I think 64 institutes of different technologies. Is run by four people, and he is the finance guru. So that is, you know, he controls the budget. As a finance person, he can be very proud, because during his tenure, the Fraunhofer budget doubled. So it went from one something billion to two something billion. So I think, thanks to, of course, everybody else, but thanks also to his very, very careful handling, I think that Fraunhofer is a very successful organization. Just to give you an indication, if I remember correctly, about the time that Alfred Gossner came to the board, Fraunhofer was getting something like 10-something million per year from the European Union in projects. Now they're up to 120 million per year. So that gives you a sign of success. I think that before Fraunhofer, Dr. Gossner was at the executive board of Allianz. Allianz is the biggest insurance company in the world, and probably you know Allianz Arena in Munich. That's why it's called Allianz Arena. And one of the reasons I admired Alfred Gossner is that he studied philosophy in Munich and then economics in London, okay, in England. So he's one of the very few persons I know that he is an expert in finance and a philosopher. And on the side, just to make things a little bit more interesting, together with his very capable wife, Nikki, he runs a stable of 40 horses, jumping horses. So he's a breeder and a trainer of horses. So if you add all these three things, a breeder, trainer of horses, a philosopher, and a top finance expert, I think there are very few people in the world that I can do all three. So, Alfred, please.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Good morning, Rector Vasily Gigalakis. Thank you so much, Dennis, for your kind introduction. As always, when you hear something like that, you always think you should like to know that person, you know, because he is, of course, exaggerating enormously. Dennis and myself have worked together at the Fraunhofer Executive Board for a number of years. That's how the connection comes about, and I think we have been friends ever since. I will not talk to you about horses, although I admit they are close to my heart. I haven't seen, by the way, many on Crete so far. Maybe we should change that and export a few good ones. I want to talk about Fraunhofer. Dennis asked me to do that. I don't see it as a lecture, you know. I will neither talk on economic theory, nor will I talk on theories of technology. I will try and present Fraunhofer to you in the sense of what it does, how it is organized, what are the key, some of the key subjects today, and then of course we could have a discussion and you can ask me anything you want and I will give you answers as much as I can. Let me just see how to use it with that one. Yeah. Okay. I thought I divided it up in four topics. I put Fraunhofer a bit in perspective within the German research system so that you understand its particular position and role. Then I will talk about Fraunhofer's organizational structure and strategy, the ways we transfer technology into the economy, which is our key job. And then I will very selectively give you some research examples and, of course, main subjects like in every country nowadays, digitalization on the one side, and new energy systems. And you know, Germany has very ambitiously embarked on a new energy system, an experiment which is not yet successfully concluded. We are in the middle of it, and I hope we will conclude it successfully at the end of the day. Okay, let's see. The German research landscape is quite complicated, and I say if you would have the task to design it, you would not design it the way it is designed. It came about in history. It has had more or less intelligent interventions, as always when governments intervene into something, and we have always tried to make the best out of it, but it has some logic. If you look at the two main dimensions which are depicted here, on the horizontal, the way of funding the system, so from pure public funding to pure private funding, and on the vertical, the nature of research, between basic research being very much, you know, the fundamentals as it is done at universities, and then up to applied research, which ends effectively with the development of new products and new production technologies. Then you see where we put the various organizations of the German research landscape. The universities, of course, in the left bottom quadrant, because they are basically publicly funded. They get some private money, not a lot, and they do basically basic research. Max Planck, which is not university but linked to the university in the sense that most Max Planck directors are also full professors, and essentially with the same mission but say with more power. Max Planck has, of course, large institutes with a lot of money, and they have a lot of power to develop those subjects very deeply. The Leibniz Association is also already one of those examples which I said are historical and not systematic. What they are is essentially is a collection of institutes which developed some over decades within the federal system. That means they were usually financed by one or sometimes more than one of the 16 German states. And at the end of the day, you know, one said, well, we need some coordination. We can't have, there are about 60 institutes. We can't have all these institutes just running around and doing something and not knowing what the other is doing. And so they brought them together in an organization which they called Leibniz. Leibniz is one of the great German philosophers and scientists in the 17th century. And so they are there. They are still not coordinated. I think there's a head office of 15 to 20 people, but they know at least now mutually what they're doing, you know, but I wouldn't argue that there's something like a Leibniz strategy. I would still think it's a collection of very diverse institutes. Helmholtz Association is very similar. We had in Germany traditionally a few large research organizations, especially around nuclear power. When we developed nuclear power in the early decades after the Second World War, 50s, 60s, up to the 70s, that what was done largely by the government. The private sector would not have, I think, would not have developed it, and maybe it would not have had the means to develop it. And the two key players were research organizations in Munich and in Karlsruhe. And then there were a few other large-scale research institutions, for example, one nearby Hamburg, DC, which runs an electron ring, similar to the one which is in CERN, not quite as big. And there is another one in Rossendorf, which also develops large-scale machinery and, say, large-scale star telescopes and stuff like that. So all these diverse institutions were put together into, you could call it a club called Helmholtz. Helmholtz, another important German scientific figure, and are now organized a little bit more tightly than Leibniz from that head office. But still, the individual parts have considerable autonomy and effectively, I think, set their own strategy. But they have common programs now, which sort of unite, in some sense, the Helmholtz organization. It's the largest in Germany. It's about 4 billion euro turnover. And it's also outside the universities. And what happened now, of course, with the effective decline of nuclear power because of our official statement, you know, of the government that we are going out of nuclear power, we are just running the current institutions off. There is no more any substantial scientific and certainly not state-financed scientific research into nuclear power. And so the two large bodies, Jülich and Karlsruhe, were effectively without a mission. And so they have taken their considerable power of, you know, highly qualified scientists and have directed them into other areas, material sciences, and all kinds of areas, because these people are, of course, very clever and very well educated. So they are now starting to do also industry-related research, because they have moved away from the focus on nuclear power. But I think they still lack a clear mission in that regard, and I see another disadvantage. You know, if you get about 80% of your budget from the government, then the incentive to become really effective in terms of the private sector is not very large. But currently, it's running, ticking over like that. Fraunhofer, you see, is here at the center. We are financed about half publicly, if you take everything into account. That means including our investments into new buildings and machinery and so on. And we are doing largely applied research, but we have some quite deep roots also in the basic research area. And we work closely with industrial companies. AIF is something special, which I don't want to explain. It's sort of cooperative councils between industries of the same industry sector who do some research together, but they are much smaller than we are. So the closest to the economic sector is Fraunhofer in terms of applied research. The interesting issue, if you look at this, is there's one dimension which you don't see on the picture, and that's the dimension of the various faculties, that is the subjects. You know, you could go with the third dimension and say, okay, there's physics, chemistry, engineering, and so on. And I think one of the advantages of the German system is that all these institutions are multidisciplinary. So we have not a system which you can observe in some other countries, where research institutions are built around, say, one broad discipline, for example, medical sciences, and then cover everything bottom up from basic to applied. Because the disadvantage of such a system, in my opinion, is that many of the modern developments happen at the borders of the classical disciplines. And if you define an institution by the academic discipline, you make it very difficult to transgress into those neighboring fields. So all the German institutions, by chance, not by design, I think, are multidisciplinary. And I believe that's one of the strengths of that system, although that system doesn't make in every regard sense. Overall, it works pretty well, but that's at least my view of it. Okay, Fraunhofer. Some people think we are more than 200 years old, because if you look at Mr. Joseph von Fraunhofer, then you see he started to live in the 18th century and died fairly early in the 19th century. Unfortunately, that's not the case. He is just our name patron. We were founded in 49 in Munich, Bavaria, and we were founded by an initiative of the Bavarian government and I think also the Americans, who were at that time, of course, very dominant still in southern Germany. And we were founded as a body which should do applied research and was fairly small at the beginning. I think there were a few scattered institutes around after the Second World War, and Fraunhofer was given the task to look after those, to manage them. They had maybe 100 million Deutschmarks budget, and so it started from very humble beginnings. By the way, if you look at Josef von Fraunhofer, he's not just a name giver, he is of course a role model, because Josef von Fraunhofer, who was an important Bavarian scientist, is very classical. The first thing is he didn't get a classical academic education at his time. He started as an apprentice producing glass, you know, window glass, whatever. And because he was a little boy of great interest and enthusiasm, he studied himself, reading books at night, and tried to develop himself and not just be an artisan, but come closer to science, which was, of course, not as organized as today. And then he was lucky. He had an accident at home. The house broke down, and he was rescued by chance. And when he was rescued by chance, he met one of the more eminent Bavarian, well, you could say businessmen. He was a man who had connections to the royal court, who ran businesses, who had money, who had influence. And this man recognized his qualities. And he started to help to develop him, you know, to give him an education, give him some money, and to make something out of a 13-year-old. It was Mr. Utschneider. And with that backing, he developed himself into an eminent scholar. And later in life, he became a professor and a full member of the Bavarian Academy of Science because he had made important contributions to physics and especially to optics. But the interesting thing is, all his life, because maybe of this origin, he worked in a combined attitude. He came from his practical experience and his practical training as a classmaker, and from his scientific studies, which he gradually furthered, and started to develop lenses and new methods of producing lenses. And you know, he really did it from the oven where you made the glass to the process of cutting those lenses. So he was, all his life, he was a developer and a designer and an engineer in a sense. At the same time, he worked as a physical scientist and developed and discovered the Fraunhofer lines in the spectrum, which are known up to today. And at the end, or closer to the end of his life, he also became a partner and a director in a production in an enterprise where they actually manufactured optical instruments and produced them. And so to the public. And you can still see some in the museums of this world. And if you happen to come to Munich, where we have our headquarters, you would see that in our attic, we have one of the biggest of those. It's a huge machine, and you can still look through it, and you see our Bavarian mountains quite close by when you look into it. So you see that they had already quite an amazing state of technological quality. So that's role model, researcher, inventor, entrepreneur. That's what we connect with his name. And that was what, by choosing his name, should be transferred to Fraunhofer-Gesellschaft. We wanted to be a society which would be acting and thinking like Mr. von Fraunhofer. Starting with research, but ending up in the real world, in the world of practical economy and of enterprises who produce things which people wanted and needed. Okay, that's basically where we are today. We grew up to about 24,000 staff, more than doubled it in the last 10, 12 years. We are organized in so-called institutes, but the institutes are practically speaking quite, you know, with quite some autonomy endowed, but they are, you could say, research units, you could also say they are business units, because they have budgets and they need to run their research according to those budgets. If they don't perform in economic terms, we will gradually start to change their nature. We will not look at them forever running deficits, because a deficit at the end of the day does not necessarily mean that the research is not good, but it definitely means that the research is not aligned with the markets. And as we are not there to fund just basic research, you know, we may transfer them to Max Planck. That happened in one or two cases. But basically, we will organize our institutes such that they are able to perform economically within our framework and maintain their own position and independence in the markets. So, like a holding.
How do you make money out of your research? I think that's not clear.
Well, we don't make money in the same sense as a private enterprise, because we get some state money. We get for what we call contract research, and that's, you see here, the biggest part of our income, about 1.8 billion. Contract research includes all research we do with third parties, be it state units, like the EU is at the end of the day also a public unit, or be private units. And in that part, in that, those 1.8 billion, we get at the moment about 28% of our income from the German government, divided between the federal and the states. And the purpose of that money is to enable us to take insights as they come from the pure research field, be it the university, be it Max Planck, be it our own people, and to go from there, from, you know, where you only have the proof of principle or the first model in the lab, to go from there to an industrial scale. Because very often you have a situation where you may well have an interesting concept. For example, the concept now to derive energy from a source like the warmth of your body. That's a basic concept, you know, which is well known, probably known for a number of years. But to go from the insight that this is possible to something which is applicable, which you can really use, takes a long way. And that will not be financed normally by the private sector. In our experience, the private sector usually does not want to invest into research on a time scale, say, longer than 3 years. And so this is bridge money to bring us from the proof of concept stage to the applicable stage, where we go to industry, or the industry comes to us and say, look, we have something which we will be able to turn into a useful technology or into a useful product within the next 2 years. That means also we are able, on the way to that, to make patents. And we do that every year, more than 500-600 new patents. And those patents we use in that area, but we sometimes can also then use it in other areas. So that's a way of transferring know-how from one sector to another sector, because what we develop with that public money is know-how which belongs to Fraunhofer and can be used now in various fields. Once you work with an industrial partner and you develop, say, a new patent related to a technology with that partner, you usually have to share that know-how. Depends on what he pays. If he pays the research completely, then the know-how belongs to him. If we share it to some extent, then we share sometimes the know-how. So these first 28% are important. And in that sense, each institute gets a basic but performance-related endowment of public money. They don't get a lump sum. Most of it is performance-related. And then they have to bring in the rest by projects from the outside. And that's why I say they have an economic metric. You know, if they don't perform within those parameters, then we will change something. Usually the first thing we change is the way they manage it. The next thing may be the focus of their research, to try to make it more relevant. And the last thing is usually the head of the institute. That happens sometimes as well. But, you know, if it does, says nothing about the quality of a person as a researcher. It may simply mean that he is not the person who is able to gear that research sufficiently to the markets. We had a few situations where we transferred a complete institute to Max Planck or to Helmholtz. Because we said at the end of the day, the way you are structured, you will not be able to perform within the Fraunhofer parameters. And we have taken up a few institutes from other organizations who have developed splendidly. One example is the large unit which Dennis was having. He headed something GMD, Gesellschaft für Mathematik und Datenverarbeitung in Germany. And that was completely transferred into Fraunhofer in 1999, 2000. And that was a unit of about, I think, 800 people?
1,500 approximately.
Yeah, okay, so fairly large unit, and they were specializing on IT issues, and they made major applications for the German parliament and other things. They were financed about 40% project, 65% public money. So they were already closer to the Fraunhofer model, but not yet there. And we took them over, and I think we transformed them quite successfully. Within the next 5 to 8 years, we transformed them into institutes which, at the end of the day, you know, fit into our model. And some of our strongest IT institutes come from that heritage. You know? And that was also the point in time where he moved over into the executive board. Okay, so. So, in a sense, we operate in our Munich center like a holding. We overlook our portfolio. We give the institute as much freedom as possible. We don't think that you can run a socialist model. That means head office knows everything better. Not at all. We want the institutes to be close to the markets and make their own decisions. But we make sure that they operate according to common standards. There are a number of issues which are above the level of an institute. There are maybe large industrial clients, which an individual institute cannot sort of serve in all regards. So that's a reason to bring in head office. There are issues where you want to consolidate some pieces of technology or know-how which come from different institutes, and where you say, but you need to take an integrated look. That's where head office comes in. So we manage what we call synergy. But we don't try to do the business of the institutes. And we organize the processes, how they work, for example. Institutes, I'll come to that in a moment, have their own strategic process. But the way the strategic process is conducted has been defined by head office, because we want everybody to follow the same method in order to be able to integrate things, compare things. That's the basic models which we operate. Contract research, as I said, the largest part of our business, is research development for industry on request. And for public partners, strategic partnerships, that's often pre-competitive research, often to some extent financed by industry, to some extent financed by public bodies. Say the EU framework programs are classical programs where you often have industrial partners and the EU. You come out with demonstrators. You have an international approach. With the EU, you always have international partners. We have our internal forefront research. That's where the 28% come in. You know, we use that money not to to administer ourselves. The administration must be financed by the projects. We use that money to finance our own internal pre-competitive research. And that's also done in a competitive model. That means we have a pot of money, and the institutes apply for that. And there are certain rules, for example, for most of that money, they must apply in consortia, where more than one institute come together. And they must demonstrate to us that they take up a subject which is relevant, which is not yet mature enough to get marketed, and which has potential. And then we let them run, say, for 2 years with that, and see where they get. And if they get into the direction where we see light at the end of the tunnel, then the industrial partners will follow. So that's what we call the internal research. We transfer a lot of our know-how through technology or product licensing. The most well-known example is the so-called MP3 technology and everything which comes after it, like AAC and so on. There are now 3-4 generations after the original MP3. That's a really successful model. Up to today, we have about 950 million license money made from that, which all stayed in the organization. Some of it we put into a special vehicle in a foundation, which is now a foundation which again finances our longer term research, but the government never touched that money. They said, you have earned it, you must do with it what you think is useful. And we produce spin-offs every year, between 15 and 20 spin-offs, often with our own members of staff, and we encourage that. And that's sometimes a painful process because it's sometimes the best and the institutes don't like them to leave. But we think it's a good idea, you know, if young people want to do their own business, we bring in the know-how. That means we become a minority shareholder of those spin-offs. The usual process is that we say, that's the idea you have, that's the business model you have, and now we are ready to hand the know-how into a new company to be founded, but the proof of the pudding is that there is also private money available to do that spin-off. Because, you know, if you only listen to the researchers, they always think they have made the greatest invention since the deep late. So they are, of course, so close to their subject that they don't necessarily oversee the markets. But if a private investor is ready to commit, say, 1 or 2 million euro in the beginning, and we commit the technology, and we have motivated people, then that's the right mix to have a startup. And so, as I said, every year about 15 to 20 startups. Right now in the portfolio, about 100 of them. We divest after some time. If they go well, if they start to grow, and we see they don't need us any longer, we sell our shares to other, to say, to fresh money to come in. So we divest regularly. Okay, organizational structure looks complicated, but isn't really that much. The leadership is at the executive board, 4 people. As I said, Dennis was one of them. And then we have the so-called spokesmen of our groups. You see the institutes here, 67 institutes, which we have clustered into 7 groups, which you see here, information and communication, life science, microelectronics, and so on. So these are grouped according to their scientific and technological competences, not necessarily the markets. That's a competence-based grouping. And the spokesmen of these groups form, together with the executive board, what we call the presidential council. But the executive board takes the really day-to-day decisions. The presidential council is more a advisory body where we debate 4 times a year about our medium-term strategy. But it makes sure that we have the know-how from the institutes actually on the executive level, because otherwise you could lose contact. So it's an important bridge for us into the institutes to have that body. We have a supervisory body called the Senate, which operates like a supervisory board in a company. It means it gets twice a year reports from us, written reports, and there are meetings. We debate our basic strategic plan with them. They have to appoint members of the executive board and to call them off, so they are important in terms of the basic leadership and structuring of the company. And they in turn are elected by an assembly of members. The members are in a sense like our shareholders, but we are not a public stock company. We are according to private law in Germany, but not a stock company called in German. It's almost like a club. Yeah? So the assembly consists out of about 700 people, or 700 units rather, and you see Germany's major industrial companies are all members of the assembly. And people like executive board members and so on are also members of the assembly. And the assembly votes for new members of the Senate and thereby has some influence on the overall direction, not too much. The Senate is important because it brings together the high-level guys from industry. You would find, say, of the DAX 30 companies in Germany, which is the largest companies in Germany, you would find about 10 to 15 at every point of time being in our Senate with a board member. So we have contact to all of these groups also in our Senate. And you have, of course, members of the state administration, state secretaries and so on are members of that Senate. And then there's on the right-hand side something called the Scientific and Technical Advisory Board. That is a, you could call it a sort of parliament of staff. That means it contains, it's about 100 people, it contains elected members of staff and it contains the institute heads. And they should make sure that we not only listen to those seven groups, but that we also listen to the concerns of staff and institute heads overall. So it's an advisory council and it talks to us regularly. So it looks complicated, but at the end of the day, it's a very practical structure. And I, coming myself from the German financial sector, I was at the beginning a bit skeptical when I saw it. I thought that's very Japanese, you know, a lot of consensus requirements, but it's one of the most effective structures I've seen in Germany. Very quick and very down to earth. That's the current board, Mr. Neugebauer, who is our president now for the last 3 years. He is a professor of mechanical engineering. Professor Rosenfeld, who came on very recently, and he's a highly qualified physician, and he looks now at those aspects like technology, marketing, and business models. Professor Kurz, who is a lawyer and does both personnel and legal affairs and also IP management. And I have essentially all other administrative things like the finance, controlling, information systems, purchasing, the building operations and all that. But while these are our respective sort of areas of responsibility, we work effectively very much like a strategic board, and we have a number of subjects which we divide among each other and where each of us takes on some responsibilities. I look after energy issues within the whole group, and I look also after some areas of the world, most things on the southern half of the hemisphere, because I've lived in South Africa myself for a number of years, and so we distribute the tasks within the board according to, well, ability and know-how. That's the strategic planning process in the group. It really starts at the level of the institute. That's the smallest circle here. The institutes make a strategic plan normally every 3 years, and in between they look at it and see whether they have to adjust it. They orientate themselves on their markets on the one side and their competences on the other side. And of course you can make moves, you can enlarge your competences, or you can try and change your markets. So you must find the ideal route. The strategic plan of the institute, as I said, is done in their responsibility in a format which is prescribed by the head office, and it is checked for relevance by something what we call the strategic audit. That means we call a board of people, some of them close to Fraunhofer, some from industry, some from the public sector, and present the strategic plan to them and ask at the end of the day the question, is that strategic plan, in your opinion, relevant and meaningful for that unit? And so that's quite a hard test, and only strategic plans which sort of get beyond that hurdle will be executed. On the level in the middle, that's the level of the groups, we see some coordination of strategic plans. For example, we have more than 10 institutes which on the head, you know, on the base of it, are, for example, related to microelectronics. Now, clearly, they don't do all the same. They are within that field specialized. But on the other hand, there is a lot of overlap, and there is also some common need for investment sometimes. Machinery in that area is very expensive. Fraunhofer is the largest organizer and administrator of clean rooms in Germany. About 6 to 8 sites with large clean rooms, and they cost a lot of money. Each clean room, you know, runs 724 and all that. So we must make sure that these investments are used in a sensible way. So we coordinate the strategic planning on the level of the group, because the groups are related through similar competences and therefore overlapping markets. We make sure that we don't invest twice in the same machinery and all that. So that happens on that level of the group. And then on the level of the company, as I said, it's synergy management, it's pre-competitive research, where we use always several and different institutes to contribute, because we believe strongly that a lot of the important developments are really made between the borderlines of the various disciplines. And of course, we have money set aside in special pots for longer term research, where we, if you so want, take a bet on the future, where we say, okay, this is a subject we think will be only relevant maybe in 10 years' time, but we invest 20 million into it now. And sometimes we are right, sometimes we are wrong. But you never know that in advance. The key issue is that you don't make too many wrong bets and that you find out early enough. So this is the structure of our strategic planning process. Okay, technology transfer, few figures. Public revenues, we have about, from public projects, about 664 million in the last year, divided on about 7,000 projects. And you see 66% of that comes from federal and countries, Bund and Länder. 16% comes from EU, 18% from others. We have industrial revenue of 641 million divided into about 10,000 projects. There are a number of small projects where you just begin something, and some of the projects run into millions, where you do really big jobs with industry. We have about 20% of our project revenue from international sources. That amounts to about 250 million each year, and that means projects which are sourced outside Germany but worked on inside Germany. On top of that, which is not in those figures, we have in more than 10 countries subsidiaries which run research businesses similar to the Fraunhofer model, say in the United States and in other places, and they may conduct projects with their countries, and they would not be in those figures. That's another 40, 50 million, about 50. Patents, we have new patent applications of about 500 per year, and we have about 6,000 active patent families, and we have about 130, in the last year, about 137 million euro license income per year, of which the largest part still is related to the audio compression technology, because that was, of course, a singular big hit. But there are other areas now, like HETV, that's the new three-dimensional television standard, video standard, that is also from Fraunhofer, that's also in those figures. We produced spin-offs last year, 24, with minority investments. We transfer each year about 10% of our staff into jobs outside. So if you would look at that in terms of an enterprise, you would think that looks highly unstable. If 10% fluctuate, that's too much. And in fact, most companies would agree with that. But I think for something like Fraunhofer, it's a good figure, because we want to transfer. It's you know, we take in the young people often directly from university, sometimes after 2-3 years experience with industry. Often when they come directly from the university, they would do a master or a doctoral thesis with us while they work part-time for projects. And then some of them even get hired on a project, you know, that the industrial partner says, look, finish your PhD and then come to us. So it's quite a figure which we like. We like to see the young people to move on into industry. Of course, we need a stable organizational structure of people who can lead our units in the medium term, and we have that. You know, we need people who run departments, who run institutes, and so on. We also get a number of our senior figures back from industry. We have quite, you know, we like it if our our institute heads are not people who have had a pure academic career. That's very rare, in fact. In many cases, they were people who may have taken a doctorate, even related to Fraunhofer, may have worked 10, 15 years in industry, and come back at the age 45, 50 and say, look, I'm still heavily interested in the scientific stuff, gone on publishing, talking on conferences, run a reasonably big ship somewhere in the industry, and now comes back and takes over one of the institutes. That's often quite ideal, because these people know both worlds, and they usually perform well in both worlds. So that's quite a model which we like. Yes, and we have a academy which offers education programs both inside and outside, and we have about 3,300 participants last year. More of half of those come from industry. That means we offer our clients very often also that we will do, in a sense, educational programs, technology education, of course, for their staff. And so they come to those academy programs. Some examples, obviously, I've just limited to MP3, as I said, the biggest in terms of money, started really in 1992. The money started to flow in from about 2004. It's a nice example that you can't plan everything in that area in a rigid way. If we would have, you know, looked at it in terms of, is there success coming, you might have killed it off after 5 or 6 years. But it was quite small, and the institute was a strong institute, and we left the institute to run with it. So the institute in Erlangen continued to invest money into something where a number of people said, look, it will not take off. The second point was, it was originally designed for a purpose which is not the reason for the success. The original purpose was compression of data, and that was in a time when storage capacity was expensive and channel width was small. That's why you needed the compression. And that didn't make the money. The money came with the internet and came with the transfer of musical titles forward and backward. And so, in a sense, you could argue the original plan did not work in the sense that this made the economic success, but the adaptation to the other purpose made, at the end of the day, the economic success. So it's an interesting example that you shouldn't kill something off too early. You must sometimes be patient and continue. New video formats, there's a live streaming, that's what I said, is now resided into HETV, where we sold a portfolio last autumn to GE, because none of the German companies wanted to have it. That's quite a feature. German companies are very cautious. They neither bought MP3, MP3 was also bought outside Germany, and they didn't buy that HETV portfolio. It was bought by GE and bought us about 170 million in one row. And again, it looks as if the Americans are sometimes more foresight. We developed, obviously, the German solar industry has been largely developed on the base of developments and successes. And one is, of course, that multiple solar cells, which has a efficiency factor of 41, as you well know, most of those cells which you have on the roofs are sometimes between 15 and 20%. And it will still take some time, but I think at the end of the day, that should be one of the solutions. And we have in recent years, together with some of the large German car manufacturers, dramatically reduced the amount of energy used up in the production process for cars, and they're probably like 35%, I think, speaks for itself. future things, always difficult to say, but we are for a number of years now engaged in this issue of revolution, which is really the development of biomarkers for early diagnostic purposes. It uses so-called non-coded RNA. You should not ask me what RNA is in detail. It's obviously something slightly different from DNA. But we are about now, we have founded a company. We are about, I think, to roll it out on an industrial base. We have partners in the pharmaceutical industry. They see it as very promising. 2013, that's an interesting example. Dandelion, especially a plant which grew originally only in Kazakhstan. It's a special dandelion, but luckily it also grows in Germany, has been transferred now to Germany. Dandelion is a substitute for natural rubber, and natural rubber is getting scarce. It comes so far mainly from Latin America, comes from trees. It's quite expensive, and there's no good substitute in terms of plastics or so. Rubbers, tires still want natural rubber, and dandelion seems to be a major substitute, and we developed that together with Continental, which is Germany's largest tire maker, and I'm quite confident that within a few years most of us will be driving on dandelion tires. Broadband, a lot of the new developments which I'm going to talk on very briefly in terms of digitalization, Industry 4.0 and all that, will require a different class of broadband than we have today. Today we are on, and I believe you are here as well, on G4, which is LTE standard, and LTE standard is by far not fast enough to do what we need for Industry 4.0. We need much more speed, and we need higher data rates, and for that we need 5G, and we are quite confident that the important parts of 5G will come from our labs. It will require different types of microelectronics, different types of chips, because you need to increase the speed on the physical base. This protection against product piracy, that's something which is integrated into ASICs. And then the industrial data space, that's something I will touch on. That's a concept which we developed together with German and European industry. We believe that the benefits of digitalization, and the benefits will be essentially new business models bringing together data from very different sources, will at the same time require a system where the owner of the data remains the sovereign of the data. That means where he keeps control of his data and doesn't say, hand them over to an American group who is happy to make the business and the money out of it. And that's something I will explain in a little bit more detail in a minute. These are examples of spin-offs which we did with MP3, so they came years later after MP3. Music Match was sold. Well, obviously we didn't get 160 million because we didn't have 100% of it. By the time, I think we had at the end maybe 8 or 10%. Coding Technologies was sold to Dolby for 260 million. I think there we were unfortunately down to 5% because we had a few financing rounds before, and not always do we follow, so we get watered down a bit. And the Mobile Music Finder was bought by Magic. Okay, two research examples which I want to mention very briefly. The first issue is digitalization. This picture just says the nature of data changes. Originally, data appeared rather as something which accompanies physical processes. You know, you need to know if you are a carpenter, you need to know how long and how wide and how heavy the wood would be, and so on. And I think this is now changing in the era we enter or have entered the era of big data, where data itself becomes a resource and enables businesses which have previously not even been thought of. An example, a very simple example, is that in the old days, Adidas or Nike or whoever else would sell you a pair of shoes, and you would buy it. If you liked it, if it fits you, you would leave the shop, and that was the end of that contact. The next thing would be that they would sell you shoes together with a little training computer on your hand, and that would at least allow some connection, and you would sort of do training programs with that device. And the shoe might even be related because it might have an electronic component which would link up with that. And nowadays, of course, you get a digitalized service. Say, Polar and others, Garmin, do that. where you are in, if you are a keen runner, you are in constant contact with the company, all your running results are in the cloud, you compare yourself with others, you get information about your health, the whole thing is measured while you run, you know, your heartbeat, your lung and so on. And so what they sell you essentially is the data service. And linked to that is, say, the device, and linked to that maybe the shoe, because one of the sensors, the sensor which measures the number of steps you make, maybe in the shoe. So the business has totally changed, you know. And obviously, the companies nowadays must be able to control the top layer. They must be able to do the data services. The shoe is probably produced somewhere in Pakistan or somewhere else where you don't need high technology. This is just, you know, the new business models can happen anywhere. And each of us know examples. And if you really happen to sit down and think for half an hour for yourself what you could imagine of, you find surprisingly many areas where new digital business models may be possible. Of course, health is one of the areas. I mean, I'm not sure how it is in this country, but even Germany, which is technologically reasonably advanced, is far behind the possibilities, you know. We still have a situation where if you feel ill for whatever reason, you go to your doctor, he will look at you, do certain tests, send it to the lab, and if the issue is not done afterwards, you know, if you are not cured, then you will be transferred to a specialist. He will again do tests, analyze you, again you may end up in hospital, and the whole thing is repeated, you know. What we could have, of course, would be one card for the patient, where you have a whole history of both your health and your treatments, and the analytic results would be there. At the end of the day, you would have to analyze the person much less in terms of new x-rays and all that, so it would be good for his body. It would be much cheaper for the system not to do the same test five times in 2 months. And the diagnostic person, the person who at the end of the day says, look, that's your problem, would know your history and would have much more information to do a good diagnostic than one who just bases it on having seen you now first time for 10 minutes. So I think we are far behind our possibilities there, and that will be one of them. Automotive. It's clear that your traffic data could be used for many purposes. One which for me as a person who worked for an insurance group at some stage are obvious. If an insurer knows your traffic data, he can offer you very different products compared to today. If you are a nice, diligent person who always drives not faster than 80 kilometers, who never has accidents, who is just, you know, because you can compare it to the data on the street network, on the grid, who just is a perfect example of a participant in traffic, you can probably be offered insurance for 10% of what you pay today. And if you are like me, that means always drive faster than you should, always sharper into the corners than you should. Okay, I don't have accidents, so they don't know anything about it. But if they knew how to drive, they would charge me much more, because they would say he is a potential risk for the traffic. But there are many more things, of course. You could, as you go, you could get information on all kinds of things. Where is the next restaurant? Where is this? Where is that? Could all be combined with your traffic data. Commerce, of course, I think there we see it already. We see it with Amazon. Amazon at the moment is about to kill a large part of German commercial sector. A lot of companies will not be able to perform against them because not only do they offer everything at very good terms, they also supply it within the next 24 hours. And currently they examine whether they will no longer supply it through cars, but supply it through drones. The next big subject, and if they do it already, we have a pilot project where Fraunhofer is in fact engaged. They do it already in some areas of the mountains, you know, where so far a postal car would have to drive half an hour up to a steep area in order to deliver five letters in a small parcel. The drone goes up in 5 minutes and puts it down and comes down again. So I think there are, and then production, of course. We look effectively of whatever you want to call it, Industry 4.0, Automation 3.0. We look at a new era of production. We look at the production era where machines will all be endowed with sensors, the parts will end up with sensors, and where those parts start, in a sense, talking to each other, and where the factory organizes itself. And that will bring enormous productivity gains. It will also change the nature of the work. Some of the simple work will disappear, some of the advanced work will become much more prominent. And it will mean that those production processes will eventually be linked not just within a production site, and that means within one company maybe, they will be linked across companies. So they will span the whole value chain from the beginning of a production process, independent of the legal unit where it is, to the end of the production process. And I think that's what we are going to see, and that's the real nature of digitalization and what is called Industry 4.0 and should be called Economy 4.0. There are challenges, as I said. We need to develop the broadband and the speed and the research of the systems, and we are not where we should be. You see, Industry and Economy 4.0 need 10 to 20-fold shorter latency times. Otherwise, you can't have coordination of machines within the production sphere. It would just be too dangerous. 12-fold higher data rates, because the amount of data will multiply, and high-performance processes. And you see also where we are at the moment, and Germany is not where it should be. The South Koreans, the Americans, and others, I'm sure, are well ahead of us. Energy system 2.0, in many ways linked to the digitalization issue. It's a big system, a subject in Germany, because the German government, some years ago, when was Fukushima? 3 years ago?
Maybe more.
Well, the Japanese meltdown, yeah. 3 years, 4 years ago.
Yeah. More.
The German government decided at the time, and it did not do that for technological reasons, it did it for mere political reasons, because 2 weeks after the event in Fukushima, we had a country, a state election in Germany, and the state election in southern Germany, in fact in Baden-Württemberg, which is one of our large and very highly industrialized and well-off countries, and which is a state which has for decades been run by the Conservative Party, because that was the mood of that place. And the election was won by the Green Party. And that was such a shock to the federal government that they said, look, obviously people are totally against nuclear power. That's the only reason why the Greens have made it. And now we must change the national strategy. And they made a very bold move. They said essentially we'll stop nuclear power within 10 years. So right now we are scheduled for 2022 to switch everything off. And that means at the same time, of course, as we had about 32% of our electric, or 28% of our electric supply would come from our nuclear power stations, we have to replace that. And certainly it would not be an answer to replace it by importing that from the nuclear power stations of the French, because that would not effectively change the system. In fact, it would probably increase our risk, because the French nuclear power stations are certainly good, but probably not better than the Germans, and they are best of us. And 80% of the time they are vested. So, you know, we don't like to have more power stations there just to get a replacement for your own. So the German government has done a very bold bet, and a bet in the sense that the technological requirements for that are not yet all available. That means we are in a race against time, and if we don't make it in time, we will have a very ugly situation. We may be forced to continue the present system and at the same time entertain the new system. That means effectively run two systems. So right now you can watch an interesting experiment. The biggest issue is not the development of the renewable energies. Both solar and wind are there, have largely been developed in Germany and have largely meanwhile also been deployed in Germany. On a good day, say in May, I think it was 10 or 14 days ago, on a May Sunday, we had a situation where the German photovoltaic supply, just what is on German roofs, was more than enough for the total consumption of German energy, electric energy on that day. So everything else, the coal, the nuclear, could have shut down. And the real problem for them is then where to put the excess. because nobody on that day was keen in Europe to take the axes, you know. What usually happens is we use the axes to pump water up in Austria into their mountain lakes in order to store energy up there, and then for another piece of money get it down again when it's raining. Not a really clever system. So the problem was not so much that. We are sure that we will have the necessary capacities of renewable energy. The problem is the nature of the renewables. And that's that there are days where you have sun and wind at the same time, and then you have huge excess, and there are days where you have neither sun and neither wind, and then you have huge deficits. And if you don't find a storage system which allows you to shift from the one to the other, then you need to run effectively a second system for the bad days. That, of course, makes everything very expensive. That's what's happening at the moment. We are running our coal-based system as a substitute, and a system like the coal-based system doesn't like it to get pushed up and down together, you know, with the renewable sources. It would like to run through on a smooth basis. So we are in a situation which is not at all easy. One part of the solution, and there are many, of course, is that smart grids and smart metering. That means the attempt to adjust the demand more to the supply. You can do that to some extent in households. You can simply, for example, use your washing machine if you are there when the sun shines. And if you would move to a system where, say, the prices would fluctuate with the relative supply and demand, we would encourage that, you know. If the price would go down the moment we have an excess supply of photovoltaic electricity, people would do that. And you could build domestic heating systems. In Germany, every house has a heating system, different to your situation here, with your beautiful climate. You could build your domestic heating system such that they contain fairly large storages of heat in terms of water. And you could use excess electricity to store in the shape of heat and so on. So you can do a lot of things, but for all that, you need that, smart grids and smart metering. Next subject is e-mobility. Clearly, a lot of the energy which we use on the streets is, first of all, not very efficient. Modern cars, maybe around 40-45% of efficiency. And secondly, of course, in the big cities, they become more and more a nuisance in terms of stick oxides and all those things which we don't like in our atmosphere. But again, e-mobility is technologically now no longer an issue. We are able to build beautiful cars. In fact, the Americans are. If you look at the Tesla, very remarkable to have done that within a few years. But we don't yet have a really good solution for e-mobility in terms of electricity storage. And current batteries are probably by a factor 10 not effective enough in terms of how much energy can you store relative to the weight of the battery. And that limits you, because if you want more energy and you have to put in another 300 kilogram into the car, you become quite ineffective at the end of the day. So again, we need urgently a solution here to get that really going. I mean, in the cities it will work. We can imagine to have fleets of cars, smaller cars probably, which are run by a commercial supplier, which you hire with your mobile, which probably in 10 years' time will drive without a driver to your house. Autonomous driving is really around the corner, and which you can use like a taxi, use it in. It drives autonomously where you want to go, and you leave it, and you get the bill through your iPhone. And it will be cheaper than today's taxis, because nobody is involved. That will work for the big cities, but still a large part of our traffic happens outside the big cities, and for that, the model doesn't work. So again, one of the areas where we really have started fairly big experiments. That's the e-mobility thing, and what I said, you know, right now they talk about special benefits, tax benefits, and other things. Mrs. Merkel wants more cars on the road. We talk about 1 million by the end of 2020. Right now I think we are probably about 50,000. That's all fine, you know. We can do a lot of things, and if we make it cheap here, we will see high numbers here. But without solving the issue of storage, we will not have a real solution. And the question will be, if it's not batteries, maybe it's something else. You know, because you combine it in different ways. You can use hydrogen, you can various things, but then you need an infrastructure for hydrogen. You know? So this is one of the open questions of the German system. Fraunhofer is heavily involved in all that. We work on almost every aspect of the e-car. We have developed, in fact, our own prototype, which is a lovely car. Unfortunately, we are not allowed to use it on the roads, but it works very well. We developed new motors, electric motors, motors which would run in each wheel. So you could do things with cars which you can't do today. You know, you could move sideways with it. You can change each wheel individually. You could increase the safety by braking each wheel individually. So that's another lovely thing we have here, a novelty in terms of the coils. You know, the coils are usually copper wires which have to be wrapped in some way. We produce them now in a cast mode with alloy. That looks very, very good in terms of energy efficiency. The floor assembly, the issue is where could you keep your batteries? Could you integrate them into a deformable structure? Because there is a risk there. And of course, we are heavily involved in the issue of autonomous driving and what goes with it. And that's an issue where sensor technology is very important and one of the future technology. I think I'm through. You know, I could go on for a while, but I don't think I should. I probably kept it already longer than I should have done, more than an hour. Thank you. So much.
I have a couple of questions regarding startups and spin-offs. One thing you mentioned is that you encourage young researchers or researchers to go to spin-offs. To follow, you know, when you do a spin-off, you encourage researchers to go, to move to spin-offs.
Yes, at least we wouldn't prevent it.
Okay.
We may not necessarily
encourage. The other hand, you do want to keep the research unit strong, because the chances are that it will repeatedly in the future give you more successes, as you show with the field.
It's a difficult decision, but you know, at the end of the day, it's been decided by the people. If people who are involved in some interesting breakthrough technology, if they want to set up a spin-off and move themselves, we would not prevent that. In fact, we would encourage it.
Okay. So another question that comes is, when you do have a success and the spin-off pays off, do you give some money back to the research unit that did the spin-off?
Yes.
And, more generally, do you have a policy?
We have two types of benefits. One is, according to German law, the invention belongs to the institution. That means all patents which are made with Fraunhofer belong to Fraunhofer, and all patents which are made with universities belong to universities. But there is a law which regulates to which extent the real inventor, and that's a member of our staff, that could even be a student, has to participate in the money made from the invention. And the law defines certain basic rules and a range, and Fraunhofer has made sure that our policy is we pay as much as we are allowed by law to inventors. You can roughly say 30% of the gross income on inventions goes to our inventors. And that will also tell you that the guys who invented MP3 are no longer in a situation where they need to work. In fact, most of them work, but they work because they like it and not because they need it. And then, so that's the first incentive to the individuals. And then there's a second incentive which we as a company pay to our institutes. If an institute spins out something successfully and loses, say, a small team, we will give that institute, to some extent, an extra grant in order to build up a new team.
And last question, do you also invest in the spin-offs, or you just give the technology?
No. Our typical model, maybe I haven't made it clear enough, is we give them the technology, which you can do in various ways. The strongest way is to transfer the patents. That usually happens on stage 2 or 3 of the financing mechanism, because the investors want then to be owners of the technology. At the beginning, sometimes we only give them an exclusive license. But the point is always, we bring the technology and the private sector outside brings the money. And for giving the technology, we get a minority share. Usually around 25%, in some cases it was up to 49%. We don't want the majority. And therefore we get royalties on it, and we get, as I've given you 3 examples here of of spin-offs which we sold, we make money on successful exits. So it's an entrepreneurial model. And you know, the investors have no problem with that. They acknowledge, you know, the evaluation models, the technology is evaluated. Say at the beginning of a spin-off, the business plan may foresee that they need €1 million for the first 2 years, and they evaluate the technology and say the technology is worth today about 200,000, then we would get 20%, and the external investor or the external investors and the staff members would get the other 80%, and the million would come from external investors. They like it if we remain there. They know that this will mean we look at it, we help it to develop the technology.
Other questions?
I have a question regarding the structure that you have shown. Essentially, at the technical level, you have shown 67 something independent institutes, parallel institutes. I'm sure there are some horizontal services that you need. I mean, like supporting legal support or patents. I mean, are they at the institute level or at the Fraunhofer level? And the second question. How strong are they, do you encourage cooperation between the institutes, even from different groups, or does it happen frequently, or are they really units that go by themselves?
So these are two questions, of course. Look, if we call the institutes independent, we must realize that's only relative and it's only an organizational concept, because legally, of course, the institutes are all part of Fraunhofer, and Fraunhofer is one legal unit. So the institutes are effectively, in legal terms, non-autonomous departments. But in our organizational structure, we give the institute has a lot of freedom, what they can decide themselves, their research programs and so on, according to their strategic plans, especially if they are successful. If success is lacking, then I said we will increasingly move in and help them to get back on the way of success. Now, you are perfectly right. Of course, there are a number of subjects which you should not do on the institute level. And we have a clear strategy, and we debated with the institutes what to do centrally, especially in terms of shared services, and what to do on the institute level. For example, my financial side runs all of the accounting. There's no accounting in the institutes. We have one common ERP system, enterprise resource system, which all the institutes we use, and therefore accounting is done with us. If you look at projects, simple industry projects, which are usually on a fixed term base, the project partner tells you, this is the results I want, and this is the amount of money I pay, and you have signed that. They can be administered at the institute level. Projects with the EU, with all their complications, you know, and all the red tape of the EU, cannot be administered on the institute level. That means we administer those projects centrally. Legal services, complex contracts with industry are all done on the central level. So we have a shared system, shared service system, which means everything which would not be worth duplicating on the institute level, we do centrally. We have about 750 people in head office now. Out of 24,000, that's not too bad. But if you look at those 750, about two-thirds of that is in fact shared services. That means they are not classical head office in the sense of supervising. They just do things which are common to everybody. For example, the IT system. The IT system runs as a total in my sort of area. And the whole administrative IT system, the fact that you get emails, that you have protection, that there's a backbone, that there is a storage, that there's overnight backups and all that, that's all done centrally for all institutes. But the local IT, if an institute runs particular IT systems as part of its business, for example, because they do engineering techniques in software production and so on, that's all that runs in their responsibility. So everything which is too costly or too complicated to do on the institute level is done as a central service and is paid for as a central service. That means the institutes pay usually on the basis of pay what you use. So we count, you know, the number of instances, we count the number of hours they use the lawyers and so on. They pay for what they use, but they pay efficiently for what they use. And it's my task, say, to get the central services organized in an efficient manner. And I tell my head office units always, we compare you regular to outside service providers. And if an outside IT service provider tells me that he will look, say, after our Windows network cheaper than my own internal guys, then I tell them to have 6 months to get on that standard, or I switch it to the outside party. So, you know, we are quite tough in that regard. There's no guarantees that you can go on with inefficient operations forever. That's nothing will be encouraged.
Okay. Sorry, there was a second part of the question.
Yeah, oh, second part was...
About cooperation.
Cooperation, yeah. One of the biggest subjects, really. Scientists sometimes are like poker players. They like to keep the cards close to their chest. We have any number of mechanisms to encourage them to work together. I said all the pre-competitive research, which we finance internally, is done in the sense that we require at least two or more institutes to cooperate. So we really give them lots of incentives to cooperate across the disciplines. And this is getting better and better. We have also, apart from the groups, which are organized according to competences, we have another level, which we call alliances. And these are groupings not according to competences, but according to market served. For example, we have an energy alliance, or we have a visual graphics alliance, and similar things like that. And these are all where... There you have institutes cooperating, coming from different technological areas, but having the same markets in focus. And that also encourages them to work together. You want both, you know, you want competition between the institutes in the sense that everybody should try to run fast and be effective. But you don't want competition in the sense that you impede the other. You want competition like in a 100-meter race. That means everybody runs in a fair way, and you want competition like you have, say, or you want cooperation like you have, say, in bicycling races, where they cycle together in a group and thereby reduce the wind objective and the wind power.
Thank you. Okay, thank you. Agnew.
Yeah, let's go back to Professor Paul, your question. What is the process to file a patent in Fraunhofer?
Well, that's standard, you know, according to German law. Say some person comes up, explains to his superior, to his institute head, what he thinks he has and why it's worth filing as a patent. And I think the first question, if they are convinced that it's a substantive piece of invention, is to see what's the patent situation around it. That would be done centrally. You know, we have central units which would search in the German and European databases what has already been patented. And in some cases, we may have neighboring patents. And once that decision is made, yes, this is an area worth occupying, because you invest money up front. You know, it costs you money first, and it may bring money 10 years later. And then we do it. And the cost is carried by the company. The inventor doesn't pay. But the cost of establishing the patent need to be paid off first, if there are any returns. And after that, we start distributing.
So I guess you have people that work on the document itself. I mean, the inventor does not work too much on it. He just gives the paper.
The inventor produces and brings up the invention. And then we have experts who check whether that's worth and able to be patented. Yeah. You don't want 24,000 patent experts. You know, you still want that your scientists to do the science work.
Yes.
I understand that Fraunhofer is mainly focused on applied research.
Yeah.
And there's a big discussion happening in Europe these days. And back in Amsterdam, it was announced that one of the flagships of EU research would be on quantum technologies, which is not exactly applied research. It's more basic research with a horizon maybe of something, of a product, longer than usual companies would.
Yes.
Invest. So, what's Fraunhofer's point of view in this kind of direction? Would you always only really look at something that has a time scale of 3 to 5 years in the use of do you also fund?
I think we are, of course, aware of that. You see, one of the important lines in the German research landscape, as I have shown it on that picture, I have said, you know, financing on the horizontal and from basic to applied, is of course, if you are like Fraunhofer in the upper part of that picture, which means in the applied area, you need a lot of connection to the basic research area. So you need a permeable structure, and that we ensure essentially by having basically all our institute heads at the same time as full professors in the large German universities. So our institute heads are each individually anchored in an environment where basic research is done, and they have to lecture there. They don't do a full professor's job because they are expected to do a good job in the institute, but they lecture there. They have connections to the students and they have connection to their faculties. So that's really important to get that up. Furthermore, we have common programs with Max Planck, and we work together with Max Planck in those areas often because we have complementary interests. If you say very loosely, you say Max Planck wants to publish and we want to make a project out of it. So we have no strong conflicts there. The third point is clearly, you know, the quantum computer has been debated for a number of years. I think we are aware of that, we watch it. I think we want to see proof of principle and something which looks workable. And then I'm sure we will take it up.
Hopefully in the next 10 years we'll have something.
Yes,
that
yes.
Nobody
knows. Yes, please.
Out of the 24,000 employees that you have in the 67, I think, institute. How many of those are doing pure research?
The 24,
if you have this number.
Okay, the 24,000 is about 6,000 part-time students, most of which are graduate students. So that's already in terms of headcount. So about 6,000 students, about, I think there may be a few hundred undergraduates, but most of them will be graduate students who do part-time work and take their higher degrees. Of the remaining 18,000, you have about 12,000 pure scientists who are largely full-time, largely. There may be a few part-times as well. And they basically concentrate on their work, be it either in the labs or being in a combining facility to the market. Then you have, of course, a number of technicians, the people who run the labs, who run the clean rooms, you know, who are able to produce a prototype. We have very elaborate workshops. In a Fraunhofer workshop, if you want a fine, precise piece of technology done handmade, you know, that will be done because often the first pieces are not done in an industrial scale. And then, of course, you have the administrative stuff. We reckon that we have about 7, maybe 8% of administration overall in the company. So that's about
And one more question.
Yeah.
So there was a slide that you mentioned that you provide 500 patents per year, 406. So 6,000 in total.
No, six. So no. You must distinguish between the patents in force. There we talk of patent families. It's about 6,000 patent families. So the individual patents are more. And the new ones coming, and there is about 500 get each year registered, and then sometime later they get in fact pronounced. You know, you first register the patent,
you file it, and
then you get it actually accepted.
Okay, but you didn't mention in the slide how much money you make out of the patents.
As I said, about last year 137 million for licensing income. And probably some more, which is not in that figure, if we sell patents. But it's very difficult to calculate the total outcome on the patents because clearly the patents are also used, and then you don't have a monetary measure to, when you talk to industry about a project, to say, look, we have on this subject certain interesting patents. That means we know how to do that. And if you get your project on that base, then the project income is not labeled patent income, but it may well be based on that patent, you know. It's very difficult to say what we really earn on patents. The only clear measure is if you sell a patent or if you get a license income on a patent. But the project-related income, you cannot attribute.
And for the majority of the patents, you license them or you get them?
I would think the majority is probably still used in the projects. I think it's some areas in particular where we make a lot of money, like the audio and the HETV and a few others, yeah.
Thanks. Any other question? Okay, thank you very much, Alfred.
Yep.
We have one professor who is also an artist, and this is a print.
Okay. Thank you so much.
One of our professors from architecture, who is an accomplished artist in Greece.
Oh, yeah.
His name is Andrea Lakis.
Well, thank you so much.
Thank you very much for coming here.